Good evening and welcome to another presentation from the Agency for Public Information. The API is your official source for up-to-date information on government's plans, programs, and policies. I am Shanna Daniel. Coming up on this presentation, Prime Minister the Honorable Dr. Ralph Gonsalves addresses this morning's fire at the Public Works Department at Anna's Vale. The Prime Minister also addresses ongoing protest action outside of the electoral office by members of the main opposition, the New Democratic Party. We also have the latest developments from the International Airport Development Company at Argyle. Stay with us for the details just after Newswatch with Keisha Woodley.
Good evening. Welcome to Newswatch. I am Keisha Woodley. First on Newswatch, in his New Year's message, Prime Minister Dr. the Honorable Ralph Gonsalves highlights several issues that require urgent action on the path of Vincentians in 2016. Two of these issues are road safety and outstanding tax payments. On the matter of road safety, Dr. Gonsalves sends a message of caution to the traveling public.
In 2016, we must do better on the roads. There's too much careless and reckless driving. Everybody knows that. Everybody is commenting on it. The motor vehicle is fast becoming a dangerous weapon. In 2015, 25 persons died in road accidents, and dozens more suffered injuries, in some cases serious injuries. Surely, all of this is unacceptable. It is true that the police must better enforce the traffic laws, but drivers of motor vehicles have an overriding obligation to drive with due consideration for other road users. In 2016, our government will embark upon a focused national conversation on this matter, with a view to implementing appropriate changes. We must be very serious on this issue. It has become one of life and death.
Prime Minister Gonsalves says that evading tax payments is a sore point for the government and those diligent citizens and residents who pay their taxes.
It is this. Too many of the taxpayers, including large and medium-sized taxpayers, simply do not pay their taxes as required under the law. Some $200 million are owed in arrears of taxes, taxes of all categories, plus the interest and penalties. Some big businesses, including a few with significant cross-border trading, do not pay all of their due taxes. Own account businesses, including professionals, are notorious in not paying their fair share of taxes. In all of this too, it is to be noted that the compliance rate for VAT is falling. A significant number of property owners, including in certain geographical areas, are not paying their property taxes. And many owners of motor vehicles are not paying their motor vehicle licenses. These are also driving their vehicles uninsured. I am publicly urging the offending citizens and residents to make satisfactory arrangements with the tax authorities, to pay up their arrears in taxes and to keep current with their tax obligations. I'm also demanding of the tax authorities to administer the tax laws with fairness and firmness. It is simply unfair that some persons get away with not paying their due taxes, while others have to carry the tax burden. Further, the government cannot properly execute its necessary and desirable programs if taxes are not being paid by so many persons. A similar complaint is being made about employers who do not pay over to the National Insurance Services their own NIS contributions and those which they have deducted from their employers' salaries their employees' salaries or wages. The NIS ought to get tough on such recalcitrant employers.
For the second year, the Ministry of Education hosted a special church service to officially usher in the new year. The service was held under the theme, Transforming Lives Through Selfless Service. It was intended to pay homage to God and to seek His direction in future educational pursuits. Special prayers were offered for all educational institutions, for all persons in administration, and all other stakeholders in education. Bishop Wendell Roberts of the New Life Ministries Church delivered the sermon. The service took place earlier today in North Union. Finally, on Newswatch, persons who are still to clear their barrels at the Customs and Excise Department will benefit from an extension of the concessionary period. Prime Minister Dr. Ralph Gonsalves has extended the Christmas barrel concession to Friday, 15th January 2016. This Christmas barrel concession began in 2001. As of January 1st, 2015 to 5th January 2016, a total of 34,140 barrels have been cleared from Port Kingstown. During the period November 9th, 2015 to December 24th, 2015, a total of 13,378 concessionary barrels were imported. Last year's annual figure was 31,224. The 2013 annual figure was 28,180, while the 2012 annual figure was 28,403. Thank you for viewing Newswatch. Good evening. I am Keisha Woodley.
Thank you for staying with us, and if you're just joining us, then welcome. This is the presentation from the API. An early morning fire at the Public Works Department at Arnosville this morning, January 7th, has destroyed a portion of the building that stores materials used for advancing many of government's social programs, including the Lives to Live program. Prime Minister the Honorable Dr. Ralph Gonsalves reacted to the news during a press conference. Dr. Gonsalves also addressed matters relating to the ongoing protest of members of the main opposition New Democratic Party outside of the electoral office in Kingstown. Here is more from the Prime Minister's press conference.
By now, the entire country knows that in the wee hours of this morning, a fire occurred at the Public Works building at Arnosville, adjacent to the E.T. Joshua Airport. At that facility, we store materials, building materials, for the Ministry of Housing. Materials, building materials for the poor, the needy, the indigent. Building materials for individuals who had their homes damaged or destroyed in natural disasters, especially since the Christmas flood of 2013, and even a residue from Thomas. And to complete the 90 Lives to Live units, which have commenced. As you know, we have done far more units, and these units are not just entire houses. The units, a bathroom, an additional room, and the like. And there are some persons who have vouchers to collect building materials and it is from that storeroom principally that those materials come. So this fire is, apart from the criminal nature of the fire, if we accept the premise of the police, because the commissioner of police indicated to me that they have a reasonable suspicion that it is arson. So apart from any possible or probable criminal character of this particular fire, this is a fire directed against the poor people of this country, the vulnerable and the marginalized. Let us call a spade a spade. This is not a fire directed at Ralph Gonzalez. This is not a fire directed at Arnim Eustace. This is not a fire directed at persons who have their mortgages and are dealing with their own housing concerns by themselves. This is a fire directed at the poor, the vulnerable, and the marginalized. Because you go there this morning and you would see galvanized sheetings which are destroyed and large quantities of plywood. They're in bundles. Thankfully, the fire was contained by the brave members of the fire services so that it has not, did not affect another area of the premises in which we also store building materials. So let us understand this. I do not want to speak to the evidence which the Commissioner of Police drew my attention to, for them to conclude reasonably that it is arson. That is not my province. That is the province of the police to speak towards at the appropriate time. But that is the thesis. That is the reasonable suspicion upon which they are operating. Then, of course, the fire takes place within a broader context. The fire constitutes part of the text. But the context is a broader one in which the opposition is not prepared to accept that they lost their elections, the elections which we had on December the 9th. And they are engendering anti-government and anti-supervisor of elections sentiments to a degree that a text can be written metaphorically, even they themselves do not write the text, that the context is provided. You who are listening to me know that. Here as members of the media, the general public know that. And the members of the opposition will also know that persons will come to reasonable conclusions. Clearly, I cannot be as irresponsible to accuse the opposition for this. Fire. I'll never do that. And no one can reasonably do so. But what we can reasonably say is that a context is being engendered, manufactured, in which this kind of behavior is accorded a veneer of legitimacy. Let us speak it for what it is. If the police are proven correct with their reasonable suspicion, it is a crime. There are two ways in which a fire can occur, one by accident and the other by arson. I do not know that there can be just a spontaneous combustion. We hear about bushfires when they have a drought. But at a building, I think that one can reasonably exclude a spontaneous combustion, that it just didn't happen by itself. It's either an accident or a deliberately set fire. And this fire takes place in the context of persons who are clearly eager to set fires. There are the two instances with flambeau, Molotov cocktails at Vinlick. That's widely reported in the press, in the media. And then, of course, the very day when we were swearing in, the cabinet members up at Heritage Square, in front of Wydie Lima, some person or persons took certain structures and garbage, put them in the road and lit them. So clearly, we have certain persons as a form of political protest. They are not opposed to lighting fires. I'm not talking metaphorically here, but literally. I am sure that the opposition will denounce the fire. I'm quite sure. And no one would be able reasonably to say that such denunciation is not sincere. But if a context is manufactured or engendered where elements whom you are leading for one reason or the other are encouraged to believe the falsehood that the elections were not free and fair, that they would themselves feel motivated to commit unlawful acts. So I want to put the position with clarity. Our people are a peace-loving people. And our police force All the members of the police force recognize this. And that is why, when people are protesting, even when they may be committing unlawful acts or maybe breaking the law, the police, as we have noticed, they have been restrained in the exercise of their authority. And clearly, they have determined in their approach to temper firmness with sensitivity. But it is for the management of the police force to consider whether or not their embrace of sensitivity has been such that it might have softened the firmness. But that is a matter for them to decide. That is a management issue of law and order, which is in the hands of the Commissioner of the Police and the members of the police force. By and large, the police have allowed protests, even when those protests are clearly in breach of the Public Order Act. And I encourage all concerned to read the Public Order Act, Chapter 396 of the Laws of St. Vincent and the Grenadines. But if in their generosity and sensitivity, there are persons who are protesting who have interpreted that generosity as sensitivity as signs of weakness, clearly, the persons who are protesting would be in error, particularly when they cross the boundaries from a simple protest to engage in activities which offend the person or property of others. Yesterday, we know that the police took a decision to clear the area of the few protesters, a handful, in front of the Office of the Supervisor of Elections. And that certain things followed as a consequence. I hear the propaganda by the leader of the opposition on television, and incidentally, SVG TV has become an instrument of propaganda. I want to repeat it. SVG TV has become an instrument of propaganda because they're showing no sense of balance and responsibility. The leader of the opposition said that the police acting in this way to clear the area will make things worse, and that it is unnecessary. What has not been reported is that at closing time on Tuesday, in the late afternoon, early evening, when the Supervisor of Elections was leaving her office, that she was assaulted, threatened, and intimidated by a person or persons who came off the protest line, came off from the gathering. And I have been advised that one of them sprayed on the wall, the external wall of the building which houses the Supervisor of Elections, 3 letters, NDP. Now, if there is that occurrence, the police is obviously enjoined to ensure that there's no recurrence of that and to take appropriate steps in accordance with the law. And I ask everyone again to read the Public Order Act. You see, the Public Order Act makes it plain that you can't have a meeting, a public meeting, within 200 yards of the courthouse building, House of Assembly building, within specified hours, or within 200 yards of a, in the language of the law, the head office of all ministries. Well, everyone knows that where we are now in the ministerial, in the financial complex administrative center, the protest or the meeting place for the protest is within 200 yards of this building. And the police naturally said, you can't stay here because the Supervisor of Elections was intimidated yesterday and people have behaved in a manner which is unruly. And the police has the authority so to disperse individuals and to ask you to move elsewhere. That's under the Public Order Act. And by the way, the Public Order Act makes it plain so that those innocent persons who are being misled. Section 6 of the Public Order Act says, for removing doubts, it is hereby declared that no person has a right to hold a meeting in a public place. And how do you define a meeting? A meeting means a meeting held for the purpose of the discussion of matters of public interest or for the purpose of the expression of views on such matters. So if you hold up placards in relation to any matter, and you're gathering, it's a public meeting. And incidentally, permission has to be given for those to be held. You have to give the notification, sorry, if not permission, you have to give the notification for the meetings to be held. Now, as I said, the police have been, over the years, been firm and sensitive. But people who are engaging in protests must know that when the boundaries are crossed and the police decide to be firm, that you must follow the police instructions. Otherwise, you, of course, you may decide voluntarily that you'll pay the price of the law. But you can't then decide that and proclaim yourself to be a martyr, or when the police touch you because you, for instance, lying down in a road, to give an example, that you declare that nobody can touch you because you're an American citizen. So And apparently, if you live in America and you become an American citizen, and you come back here, you're inviolable because you're an American citizen. In other words, the imperium of belief in the supremacy of Americanism gets into your own head to tell you how these people are delusional. Gets into their own head that you then become an untouchable. Now, again, for the benefit of those persons, and I don't want to dwell on you here, Parnell Campbell is much better at that than I am, and he's been doing excellent work. Section 67 of the Criminal Code, Chapter 171, says, when three or more persons assemble with intent to commit an offense, or, and this is where it's relevant, or being assembled with intent to carry out some common purpose, like if you want to carry out a common purpose to protest about something, or being assembled with an intent to carry out some common purpose, conduct themselves in such a manner as to cause persons in the neighborhood reasonably to fear that the persons so assembled will commit a breach of the peace, or will by such assembly needlessly and without reasonable occasion provoke other persons to commit a breach of the peace. They are guilty of an unlawful assembly. It is immaterial that the original assembling was lawful. If being assembled, they conduct themselves with a common purpose in such manner as aforesaid. A person who takes part in an unlawful assembly is guilty of an offense and liable to imprisonment for 1 year. This law is the law which we met here, which is a sensible law, which has stood the test of time. Now, and the person who was responsible for the codification of the criminal laws of this country is Mr. Parnell Campbell QC. They only published in a different volume. I understand that some people feel, and I'm not commenting on any particular case, that if you have a licensed firearm, it is perfectly in order for you to attend a meeting, a gathering, with a licensed firearm. Section 14 of the Public Order Act says, prohibition of offensive weapons at public meetings and processions. Mind what I said earlier about what is a meeting and what is a public meeting. Any person who, while present at any public meeting, has with him any offensive weapon, otherwise than in pursuance of lawful authority, is guilty of an offense. Well, you may say that if you have a licensed firearm, that's your lawful authority. Well, the law long stops you and says, don't go so fast. The law is right reason, you know. At least 99.9% of the time. Occasionally, the law may be an ASS. But the law is basically right reason. It says here, for the purposes of this section, that is, having the offensive weapon, a person shall not be deemed to be acting in pursuance of lawful authority unless he is acting in his capacity as a servant of the Crown. For example, you're not the servant of the Crown if you are an ordinary person going about your business, or a successful or defeated candidate for that matter in an election. Unless he's acting in his capacity as a servant of the Crown or of any local authority, or as a police officer, or as a member of a recognized corps, or as a member of a fire brigade. And that which offends people's right reason is in the law, you know. It is prohibited. And that carries a term of imprisonment of 3 months and $2,000 fine. So I don't want in any way to throw any cold water on anybody protesting, because I understand protests. But just know that there is a legal framework. Know your boundaries. Stay within them. And if you are taking liberties with the boundaries and the police pull you up, abide by what the police is telling you, or suffer the consequences if the police decide to take action under the law. A person may say, well, listen, I'm going to protest nevertheless and I'm going to break the law. Well, if you decide to do that, well, there are consequences, and if you're prepared to abide those consequences, well, that's your personal decision. But there are a lot of innocent people. I want to advise them. Just be careful. We notice that a context for the propagation of information is being inflamed by a number of persons who are on social media, most of them living in the comfort of overseas. You would have seen them. Their calls to assassinate Ralph and his family. Their calls to burn down Ralph's dwelling house, his personal property. They're encouraging people in the act of terrorism to burn down the city. I want to hear what the leader of the opposition is saying about this. And some of the persons who are articulating these things were here during the campaigning for the NDP. I want to repeat that. There are persons who left the United States, who left North America to come here to campaign for the NDP, and have gone back, some of them, and from what they believe is the safety of their home in Brooklyn or wherever, to encourage this kind of lawlessness, I just want to say to them that the police directly and through the Ministry of Foreign Affairs have informed the American authorities and provided examples of these postings. I just want to make that point. And I happen to know that the ambassador himself, the American ambassador to St. Vincent and the Grenadines, has been engaged to be made aware of the use of this illegality on U.S. soil, directing terrorist activity against St. Vincent and the Grenadines. and the leader of the country. I have not spoken on this before, but in the light of this fire this morning, I want to inform the public.
That was Prime Minister the Honorable Dr. Ralph Gonsalves speaking from Cabinet Room during a press conference earlier today. This is the presentation from the API. Let's take a break now. When we come back, we'll join Jennifer Richardson, the Communications Officer of the International Airport Development Company, for this week's IADC update. Stay with us.
Hey, let's go on holiday.
But where to exactly?
Right here in SVG. We can spend the night in Bekwe, go scuba diving in the Tobago Keys, go shopping in Kingston, and spend a nice quiet evening in a hotel. Charter a yacht and sail the Grenadines. We have it all right here in St. Vincent and the Grenadines.
Ah, that's a very good idea.
Let me start packing.
This is a message from the Ministry of Tourism.
Tourism today, tourism tomorrow, tourism always.
Applications are invited from suitably qualified persons who wish to be considered for temporary positions under the Support for Education and Training SET program, commencing 2016. Application forms and brochures are available at the following locations: the Office of the Prime Minister, 4th Floor, Administrative Centre, Kingstown, Service Commissions Department, 2nd Floor, Ministerial Building, Kingstown, online at www.pmoffice.gov.vc and www.psc.gov.vc. Completed applications should be submitted to the Cabinet Secretary, Office of the Prime Minister, 4th Floor, Administrative Centre, Kingstown, or the Chief Personnel Officer, Service Commissions Department, 2nd Floor, Ministerial Building, Kingstown, and should be submitted along with the following: a certified copy of birth certificate, certified copy of qualifications, two recent testimonials, curriculum vitae, recent police record, and a picture of applicant. Only successful applicants will be contacted. The deadline for receipt of applications is 31st January 2016.
Welcome to your weekly IADC update. Before I go any further, let me take this opportunity on behalf of the management and staff here at the IADC to wish each and every one of you a very happy and prosperous 2016. 2016 will definitely be the year that your dream of having an international airport is realized. Yes, 2016. And we want to thank you for your support in the past for the project, and we thank you for the support that you will continue to give until we have made this project operational. We are back out here in the field today to update you as to what is happening here at the Agadir International Airport, and as we continue to prepare ourselves for the operation of the Agadir International Airport in early 2016, we are continuing with the work. We have not let up during the Christmas season. The work continued, and as you can see and will see throughout this update, it is moving a pace. Now, where we are here this morning, we're on the eastern side of the passenger terminal building. We're right here between the apron platform and the 191 channel. And the work that you're seeing taking place behind me, that is in preparation for the expansion of the commercial apron. Yes, we are expanding the commercial apron so that instead of two wide body jets being able to park side by side here, we'll now be able to park three wide body jets here on the commercial apron. So the guys have done their clearing, they have done some filling up, now they're putting in some material, so you'll soon see some compaction of that work before they get to the stage of having to do the pavement work. So all this preparatory work is taking place here to enable the expansion of the commercial apron. On my left, we have the 191 channel where we are continuing to work on the drain there. The drain has been constructed in this area, and what they're doing now is that they're covering the drain, and it's taking quite a while to have it covered because it is a tremendously long drain. On the other side of the drain, they're also continuing construction work. Very soon we'll see that they will break the road there just between where the water is flowing, and they would fix that part of the drain to allow the water to be able to flow right down to the Argyle Ocean into the drain that we have constructed. So that's some of the work that's going on here right now. A lot of work concentrated in this area. We have work going on all around the site, but there's some areas where we have more concentration, and this is one of them. We also have a lot of work being concentrated in the 220 channel. So we're going to go over there now and show you what they're doing over there and how far they have come since last we visited them. So don't go away. Stay with us. We have lots more to come. As mentioned before, there is a lot of work taking place there at the Argyle International Airport site, and we have the areas in which most of it is concentrated. Now, just below here, where we're overlooking the third kilometer of the project. Now, if you look closely behind me here, in this area right here, this is where the Yambu River once ran. Of course, it flowed from Maracua, come right down, it came around here, down back to the Argyle Ocean. We have since rerouted the river, pushed it into the culverts on the other side, and we are working towards filling up this area now. Now, as you can see for yourselves, that area is almost to where we need it to be filled, so that we can then put our base material on and start our compaction and do all the necessary work we need to do before we start even thinking about asphalting the runway. So the runway is to be continued coming across here, and this is all part of the work in preparation for that. Filling up here, leveling it off, compacting the sand, making sure everything is okay. And across where we built the metal culverts, where we installed metal culverts, all of that area is also covered right down, as well as on the other side, going back that way towards Yambu. So a lot of work in this area. Of course, you understand and appreciate that this, at this particular juncture, is perhaps the most critical thing that we have to do here at the Argyle International Airport site. We have to get this done so that we can continue and complete the construction of the runway to facilitate the operation of the Argyle International Airport. Also in this area, but to my right, where we have for some time completed the construction of the turning head, they are now doing some finishing work around the turning head, and we are seeing the asphalt pavers on site. The guys are busy doing some asphalt work around there to complete. So a lot of finishing work being done here at the Argyle International Airport. And of course, they continue to take down the soil from off the bank sides and across over there as well. And all of that material is being used to fill and level off the areas that we need to be working in right away. So those are some of the critical things that are being done here right now at the Argyle International Airport. We're gonna move from here, we're gonna go across to the cargo terminal building, where finishing work is also being done. So come with us as we take you across there. Well, thanks for staying with us. We have moved over into the second kilometer of the project, and we are standing right in front of the cargo terminal. Of course, I said we are standing in front of it, but this is really the back of the cargo terminal, and it is in this area behind here where you'll find the loading bay. So according to the plan, the trucks that are being loaded would come, or offloaded, would come behind here, and the forklifts would just take the stuff and go inside there. Now, for those of you who've been wondering if forklifts would be able to operate in there, because from looking at it from the outside, it looks pretty small, it looks kind of not too tall from the pictures that we would have posted or from the pictures that you would have seen before. But I want to reassure you that they'll be able to move freely, that it is very, very high inside there. There is enough room for them to maneuver as much as they would like. So we will take you inside and we will show you exactly what it looks like in there now that they are nearing the completion of this structure. Now what they told me they're doing now is basically finishing work, because by and large the building is up, all the wallings, the structure is in place, so they're pretty much all they're doing is finishing the work. Of course we have three sections in there. We have the import area, the export area, and then a small area for offices for those who are managing the place to operate in. So this is the cargo building here being readied for operation. And next door to it we have the electrical substation, the airside electrical substation, and that too is seeing finishing touches being done on it to have it to completion. So that's some of the work taking place here. We're going to go inside and show you what it looks like. So take in all the sites and see what we're talking about. You have just seen it, the cargo terminal building inside and out, and you now understand when we say yes, there is more than enough room in there for forklifts, etc., to operate unimpeded by anything. In front of me here, I'm standing here on the apron platform. In front of me we have guys at work covering the drains right in front of the platform, and all of that is in preparation for operation of this airport. And of course, like we mentioned before, throughout this program, that we are really doing a lot of finishing work at this time. The terminal building has been ready, the physical structure, for a while, and the retrofitting continues. In the new year, we will see a lot more work being done in there in terms of the installation of the seats and the computer system for the checking in areas, etc. So all of those would be done very early in the new year. This is all that we have for you for today from the IADC. Enjoy your new year. May the best of it. May God bless each and every one of you, and may it be a prosperous 2016. Good evening. We'll see you next time.
And that's how we end this evening's presentation from the API. I trust that you found it to be quite informative. Thank you very much for viewing. Until next time, I am Shanna Daniel. Good night and God bless.